Swayam Prabha, Digital India, Educated India.
It is going to happen only when if we are already at the maximum point, or if we are at a point where the function value is maximum. So in that case, we can say if all the lambda values are negative for the active constraints, then we have reached the maximum point, or where the function value is going to be maximum. We are going to explain this further through an example. In this example, we are trying to minimize a function with two variables. You can easily see this function represents a circle, and our two variables are x1 and x2, subject to the constraint, which is x1 plus 2x2 less equal to 15, and x1 value is between 1 and 10. X2 value is also between 1 and 10. Now, this inequality constraint, if you want to represent it with the transformation to consider this inequality, we can easily write that equation. Here is our objective function, and here are our constraints. So the first constraint, which we said, is here. Since x1 is supposed to be greater or equal to 1, so we can rewrite that as the second constraint. We also said x2 is also greater or equal to 1. We can rewrite it in this way. We said x1 is going to be less equal to 10, that we are writing it in this way. And we said x2 is going to be less equal to 10, so we can write it in this way. So this becomes our 5 different constraints. Now, it is a proper multivariable optimization problem with inequality constraint, and this inequality constraints, we can convert it into equality constraint by adding the slack variables. So once we add the slack variables, my constraints are going to change as shown here for each case. So my multivariable inequality constraint is now transformed into multivariable equality constraint. So if we want to solve this, so let us understand the directions we were talking about. To understand that, let us represent this in a graphical format. So as I said, my objective function represents the circle. So these are my objective function value for different combination of x1 and x2, and the constraints. So the first constraint, we said it is less than 15, so x1 plus 2x2 is going to be less than 15, which is here. So that constraint, this is my g1. My second constraint was where x1 was greater or equal to 1. So this is my second constraint, g2. So if we say greater or equal to 1, means this part is infeasible, means our values should be on the right hand side of this line. So I'm crossing out the left hand side. Now for the previous constraint, which was x1 plus 2x2 less than 15, for that this is my infeasible zone, so the top part of the line is infeasible. My third constraint was when x2 was greater or equal to 1, which means this line is going to be my third constraint, g3, and the feasible portion is on the portion which is above the line. My fourth constraint says that the x1 value should be less equal to 10. So the green vertical line represents the fourth constraint G4, and the points which are on the left hand side of this line are feasible. So I am again hashing out the infeasible area of this. And my fifth constraint says that my x2 should be less equal to 10. So this line represents my last constraint G5, and the points below this line are going to be feasible. So I am hashing out the top part of it. Now in this example, in the graphical representation, it is very clear to us that this particular constraint is redundant and is going to remain permanently inactive. Our active region or feasible region lies between A, B, C and D. So we need to find a point within this A, B, C and D where my function value, which represents the circle, is going to be minimum. Graphically looking into this part, we can say that the minimum value is right here, because we cannot move any further on this side. So this is my minimum point, and this is lying on the constraints, two of the constraints, which is G2 and G3. So at this point, my active constraints are G2 and G3. But when we are looking into the solution, we exactly don't know where the solution is unless we plot it in this graphical format. So we need to find out the active constraints. For this purpose, we have four constraints, because this constraint is permanently inactive. So eventually we have four constraints. Out of that, we have to find out how many are going to be active. Now we have two variables. So two variables means at a time we can have at max two active constraints, and our solution is going to be at the locations where my active constraints are satisfied. So if I am looking into the active constraint G2 and G1, then my solution point would be somewhere here. If I am looking into the active constraint G1 and G4, this is my common point, so my solution could be here. If I consider my active constraints are G3 and G4, my solution could be here. And if I am looking into G2 and G3 as my active constraint, my solution is going to be at point B. So point A represents one and seven. So if this is one of my extreme point, I can say XA. Other extreme point, I can say XB is equal to 1, 1. Third one is going to be 10, 1. And the fourth one, XD, is going to be 10, 2.5. So if we choose randomly a point and try to find out which direction we can move so that we are still in the feasible region and our function value is reducing, then our solution process can move on in that particular direction. If we cannot move, then we know that we have reached to an optimum point. Only by the nature of it, we have to identify whether it is a maximum or minimum. So let us look into the gradient of the objective function and the constraints. The gradient of the objective function, if you are looking into it, is going to be this one. The constraints, the first constraint gradient is this, second constraint gradient is this, third one is this, fourth one is this, and the fifth one is this, even though it is not active, but we have calculated it here. Then, as I said, we have four points A, B, C, D, or if we consider XA as the first point and represent it as X1, and this point we want to see if we can find a feasible direction to move or not, then we need to find out the gradient value of the objective function at that point, as well as we need to find out the gradient value of all the constraints. Now, if we see the gradients, only in the objective function we have the gradient which is dependent on my location. So in this case I am choosing the location as 1, 7, so for that the gradient of my objective function is going to be this one, and other gradients are already a number which we can consider. So from this location we need to find the search direction, and as I said earlier, this location is here, and if you are looking the search direction, it should satisfy the constraints, which means direction can be feasible only when if I pre-multiply my gradient with the direction, then that should be less equal to 0 because my constraint was less equal to 0. So from here, if we try to find out any direction in this direction or along this line, all these are going to be feasible. And it also need to ensure that in that particular direction, my function value is also going to be reduced. So we can say that direction is usable if the gradient of objective function pre-multiplied with the direction is going to be less equal to 0. So if we choose a direction, in this case S equal to 1, -1, and try to see the value, then we know that 1, -1 is going to give me a negative value for this component, because 1, -1 multiplied by 2 and 14, this is going to give me 2, -14 is equal to -12, so which is less than equal to 0. So this direction we can definitely use because my function value is going to reduce in this direction. And in this particular direction, if we see my gradient, the first gradient is going to be 1 by 2, which is going to be -1. So it satisfies the first gradient, it is a feasible direction with respect to the first constraint. So this was my first constraint g1. With that, if I go any direction, it is feasible and we can use this particular direction. Likewise, if we see for the second gradient, we'll see that it is a feasible direction as well. My second constraint was this, and with that respect, all the directions are fine. So it clearly indicates my search direction. If I choose 1, minus 1 is appropriate from this particular point and go towards the location where my objective function is further minimized from this particular point. So it could be a feasible solution or feasible direction for further use. Now, if we are at this location, let's see what happens. In this case, if we are trying to find out the value of the gradient of my objective function, it is going to be 2, 2, this vector. And if I choose any direction where both are positive, then this is going to be positive, and any value, any positive s1 and positive s2, which represent s, is going to yield this component as positive, which is not going to satisfy this condition. So I cannot move any of these directions, are not feasible for me or not usable for me, even though those could be feasible because it will satisfy this equation. So from here, if I look into my g2, g2 was minus 1 and 0. And g3 was 0 and minus 1. So any positive value or any positive direction, if we consider, it is definitely going to satisfy this condition as well as this condition, which means it is satisfying the constraints, but it is not reducing the function value, rather it is increasing the function value, which means I have reached a point where the function value is minimum. What happens if we choose any other direction which is partially negative or completely negative? Either both are negative or one is negative, another is positive. So suppose this is positive and this is negative, or this is negative, this is positive. In any of these cases, you will find that one or the other constraint, this component or this component, is not going to be satisfied, means it is going to violate the constraint. So for example, if we want to move in this direction, my g2 constraint is violated. If we want to move in this direction, then my g3 constraint is violated. And if we want to move in this direction, my both constraints are going to be violated. So this direction represents both negative, this direction represents one as positive, the other as negative. So x direction is negative and the other one is positive. Hence, this one is not going to be satisfied. However, this will be satisfied. this direction represent. The first is positive, the next one is negative. In this case, G2 will be satisfied, G3 is not going to be satisfied. Even though all the three directions are usable with respect to the objective function, as this component is going to be less than 0 or this component is going to be negative. So this is about the direction. This direction is going to be useful in further analysis. So in today's lecture, we saw how we can convert the multivariable inequality optimization problem into a multivariable equality constraint problem, and then use the Lagrange multiplier to represent the multivariable equality constraint problem. And when we use the Lagrange multiplier for the solution, then we come across the active and inactive constraints. And when we could identify the active and inactive constraint, we could actually reduce the number of equations that needs to be solved to find out the solution. And in that process, we also found out that how we can use the lambda values to understand whether we have reached the optimum point, rather saying we have reached the maximum point or the minimum point. So these are quite interesting to find out, and how we can solve the multivariable optimization problem with inequality constraint. Now we also got to a point where we need to identify the direction or the feasible direction for finding the optimum value. So we have certain process to solve that, and which we are going to discuss in the next class. So till then, thank you and see you in the next class.